The format is going to be like this. Each of the authors is going to introduce his book for about 10 minutes. Then we're going to talk a bit about history and take a Q&A. We've allocated a generous 20 minutes for the history of the Middle East, including questions and answers. And then we're going on to discussion about the present and the roots of the current difficulties we have in the era described in this book. And we'll have Q&A then, and I'm a ruthless chair, so if you want to give a long lecture or even a long whining diatribe, save it for later. We like short, sharp interventions to the point and preferably good-humoured. We will finish on the dot at 8:30. I'm going to go to Scott first. His book's actually about four characters, very interesting, different characters, but the lead character is Lawrence of Arabia, although the book is Lawrence in Arabia. And there's a lot about Lawrence, and also a marvellous paragraph, which I'm just going to read you to set the stage for Scott's presentation. He lists all the ghastly things which he says what transpired over the past half century is familiar to all: wars, convulsions, state-sponsored terrorism, interventions, unbroken string of cruel and kleptocratic dictatorships, majority of people impoverished and disenfranchised. And he says that the blame for this doesn't rest solely with the terrible decisions made at the end of World War I. But it was then that one particularly toxic seed was planted. Ever since, Arab society has tended to define itself less by what it aspires to become than by what it is opposed to: colonialism, Zionism, Western imperialism, and so on. And that's just one of the many wonderful apostues and aphorisms in the book. But without more ado, I'm going to give the floor now to Scott to introduce your book and how it has brought us, those tumultuous years have brought us to the dreadful position we're in now.
It's all good to the book.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. It's a challenge compressing 5 years of work into a 10-minute talk. So what I'm mainly going to talk about today is Lawrence, T.E. Lawrence, and his relationship with Faisal. Just very briefly, Lawrence's background. He was from the British upper middle class. One great detail: his last name actually wasn't Lawrence. It was his last name should have been Chapman. His father was a member of the Anglo-Irish aristocracy, named Thomas Chapman. He'd run off with the governess. His wife had not given him a divorce. So, as he started his second family, and Lawrence being the third of five sons, the family lived a fugitive existence. By the time T.E. Lawrence was 8 years old, he'd lived in six different places around the British Isles. So this family grew up in a very emotionally constricted and almost a fugitive existence. The parents were deathly afraid of ever, especially the father, of ever crossing paths with someone who knew him from his prior life. So this physical constriction to the family. In light of that, it was a tremendous risk that the father took in moving the family to Oxford. He wanted his sons to have an excellent education, but certainly in a place like Oxford, it was most likely a place where he would cross paths with someone who knew him from his past. The family moved to Oxford. T.E. Lawrence, who's known by the family as Ned, went to the Oxford City High School for Boys. He was a good student, shy, kept to himself, had a very small group of friends, developed a fascination with archaeology at a very young age. This was a time when there was a great deal of construction in Oxford, and whenever they on these construction sites, Lawrence would dig around and find mostly old, ancient bits of pottery, and it fueled his interest in archaeology. When he was admitted to Oxford University, he was studying military history and specifically medieval battlements. For his thesis, he decided he was going to go to Syria and conduct a walking tour of the Crusader castles in Syria. And already Lawrence, with this dogged determination that he had, he wasn't going to just go to some of them, he was going to go to virtually all of them. And so at the age of 19, he set off for Syria by himself and walked 1,200 miles across the Syrian interior. When he came back and he graduated, he got a little stipend from the university to study French medieval pottery. And he had been at that for about three days when he heard that the British Museum was sending a archaeological expedition to the Hittite ruins of Carchemish, which is in northern Syria, today on the border between Syria and Turkey. He talked his way on as a junior helper. He spent most of the next 5 years, and this is the 5 years immediately prior to World War I, at Carchemish. And what was clear in the time he spent there, he developed a deep and very quick affinity for Arab culture. And more than an archaeologist, he really studied the way Arab society worked. And he would, with the local workmen, he would go to their homes and develop very, very sophisticated family trees of some of these workmen. Wanted to understand the way society worked. He had just come back to London from the dig in Carchemish when World War I broke out. Turkey didn't, the war of course started in August of 1914. Turkey didn't come into the war until November and came in on the side of the Germans. Lawrence was 5'3", some people say 5'4½". He was too short to join the military. But when Turkey came into the war, because he spoke Arabic and he was seen as something of an Arab expert, he was admitted in the military and sent as a military intelligence officer to Cairo. British Egypt being the main staging ground for the British war effort against the Ottomans. For the next 2 years, Lawrence was mainly stuck behind a desk. But during that time, he certainly learned about the negotiations that were going on between Amir Hussein, the Emir of Hejaz in Central Arabia, and the British High Commissioner in Egypt toward raising an Arab revolt against the Ottoman Turks. The main British interest in, of course, was in sponsoring the revolt, partly military. It gives the Ottoman Turks something else to think about, but also largely political. Amir Hussein was the spiritual guardian of the Islamic holy cities of Mecca and Medina, and it would negate the effort by the Turks and by the Germans of portraying the French and the British as modern-day Christian crusaders. The Arab revolt was launched in the summer, in June of 1916. Lawrence's, and it very, very quickly ran into trouble. They took a few cities in the surprise of the first few days, and then it rather fizzled. And Lawrence first went to Arabia in October, four or five months after the revolt had started, essentially as a tag-along for a British officer who was going to try to see what could be done with the revolt. Lawrence was only in Arabia on his first trip for 10 days. And in that 10 days, he managed to meet all four of Amir Hussein's sons, and they were the primary battlefield commanders. But most importantly, he met Faisal. Lawrence was the first British officer to be allowed to travel into the interior of Arabia, it being Holy Land and closed to infidels. And in the interior, he met Faisal, and as he famously wrote in Seven Pillars of Wisdom, his war memoir, he instantly saw in Faisal his, quote, prophet of war, and he saw him as the real leader of the Arab revolt. After 10 days, Lawrence went back to Cairo, and in very short order, he managed to get himself brought back over to Arabia, first as the temporary liaison officer to Faisal, but then very quickly as the permanent one. As he took up those duties, though, Lawrence harbored a guilty secret. He also knew that in addition to the promises that had been made to the Arabs, the British government had entered into a secret agreement with the French, the Sykes-Picot Agreement, which in the agreement with the Arabs, they had the British granted sweeping independence for the Arab nation, for virtually the entire Arab nation, the entire Middle East, the entire Arab world, with a couple of small exceptions. In the Sykes-Picot Agreement, now almost all the Middle East, all the good parts, were going to be divided between the French and the British, with the future Arab nation relegated to the wastelands, at the time the wastelands of Arabia. So as Lawrence was engaged in recruiting and helping enlist Arab tribes to join in the Arab revolt, he also carried this secret, and knowing that in all probability, at the end of the war, the Arabs were going to be betrayed. Within a few months, he was already so conflicted with a kind of a dual allegiance, divided loyalty, that he took Faisal aside and told him about the existence of the Sykes-Picot Agreement. Why did he do that? I think part of it was this personal thing. He felt caught between his loyalty to the Arab cause. He was certainly a very committed Arabophile at that time. But I think also he felt that the British government were on a collision course, that this idea of dividing the Middle East and the Arab world between imperial powers was going to lead to disaster. As the war progressed, Lawrence became increasingly conflicted by carrying this secret, and he refers to himself in Seven Pillars as a fraud and a charlatan, to the point where in the closing days of the war, it almost seemed like he was trying to get himself killed. He was leading almost suicidal charges against the Turks. But what kept him going was he had this idea that if he could get the Arab army to Damascus first, Syria having been promised to the French in the Sykes-Picot Agreement, if he could actually get the Arab rebels to Damascus before the British army got there, that somehow that could be turned into thwarting French designs, and the British would be forced to give Syria to the Arabs. The regular British army and the Arab rebel army got to Damascus essentially simultaneously, right at the very beginning of October 1918. It's a very famous meeting at the Victoria Hotel in Damascus with Faisal and Lawrence and General Allenby, the British commander-in-chief in the Middle East, where Lawrence was in the process of setting up a provisional government that would recognize Faisal as the king, and Allenby said, sorry, it's going to the French, and said to Lawrence, you knew this, didn't you tell him? Lawrence, at that meeting, Faisal left the room. Lawrence stayed behind and said he wanted to quit the military. And at first, Allenby said, well, you can't quit, the war is still going. And Lawrence said, I'm of no use, I want to go home. And the next day, he left Damascus, never to return. He went back to London, and what he immediately started doing was trying to marshal allies for the upcoming peace conference. This is now October. The war is not even over yet. And as they move towards the Paris Peace Conference, which started in early 1919, he first tries to find allies within the British government. He has some, but increasingly the idea of handing over to the French takes sway. The Americans, Woodrow Wilson's come over to talk about the rights of small peoples to independence. He doesn't get anywhere with the Americans. And he ends up in one of the most controversial, and I know Professor Alawi is probably going to talk about this, having Faisal enter an agreement with Chaim Weizmann, the head of the British Zionist Federation, where in return for recognizing Jewish primacy in Palestine, that this was the Balfour Declaration had come out a year before, which it was the official British policy to encourage Jewish immigration to Palestine, that in return for that, the Zionists would support the Arab claim to Syria. In the end, all of that, none of it came to fruition. Lawrence was effectively banned by the British government from the Paris Peace Conference and banned from advising Faisal. And so Faisal was basically forced to accept the French and French and British imposed peace. I think I'll end it there, and I'll hand over to Professor Alawi.
Thanks very much indeed, Scott. And I should have said at the beginning, I introduced Scott's book, I should have said he's a veteran American war correspondent, and his book got off to a flying start with 150,000 copies sold in the United States and was named as one of the best books of 2013 by the New York Times. But anyway, Lawrence is, if you like, the really well-known guy. Everybody, I guess, in this audience has seen the film Lawrence of Arabia. Many people will have copies of the Seven Pillars of Wisdom sitting appreciated but unread on their on their bookshelves. But what I particularly liked about Professor Ali Alawi's book was it was giving the other end of the story, which has really, I think, not been told, certainly not with this level of detail and insight in English before. This is the story told from the Arab point of view, with both command of the English sources and the Western sources, but also with very thorough use of the Arabic language sources of memoirs, of which there are surprisingly many to those of us reared on this rather sort of orientalist view that it didn't happen unless someone from Europe wrote it down. And Professor Alawi needs no introduction, really, but he was Minister of Defence and Minister of Finance in different Iraqi post-war governments. He's currently research professor at the National University of Singapore, was ranked fourth on Prospect magazine's poll of 2013 World Thinkers for his thoughts on the history and the future of Islamic society. Ali Alawi, the floor is yours, and please speak up.
Thank you very much. I'll ask if you can all hear me. Okay. Most of those who have heard about Faisal probably heard about him or saw him in the film by David Lean, Lawrence of Arabia, where played memorably, I think, by Alec Guinness. And he also featured in another film called Sirocco, which had Humphrey Bogart, but he was off stage, so it was quite hard to discern his outlines. And he was also played by, I think, an actor called Art Malik, an early 90s film with Ralph Fiennes called, I think, Lawrence After Arabia. But that didn't really get much traction. So why is he such an important and significant figure? And why in the end do I call him in the epilogue Faisal the Great? Because I think that is what he was. He was one of the greatest statesmen and figures of modern Arab history. And in my reckoning, he's probably, I would call him the Arab Simon Bolivar. He was born into the Sharifian family of the Hejaz. These are probably the most noble Arab family around. They have been guardians of the sanctuary in Mecca since the 9th and 10th century. So they've been around for nearly 1,000 years, and nobody could really question their pedigree or lineage, which traces back to the Prophet Muhammad through his grandson Hassan. And they have been hereditary custodians and guardians of the shrine in Mecca. Now, why is that really a significant position to have? Because the main task was to guard and to safeguard and to look after pilgrims going to Mecca. And as you know, this is one of the pillars of the religion of Islam. So being custodians of the sanctuary gave them enormous prestige and gave them also an enormous leverage on the political powers that be. And whatever empire bestrode the area or the continent, one way or another had to deal with the claims of the rulers of Mecca. And throughout the various ups and downs and vicissitudes of the Islamic empires, they maintained their privileged position as guardians of the holy sanctuary. And when the Ottomans took over the Middle East in the early 16th century, they also recognized the supremacy of this family, which in turn recognized Ottoman authority or suzerainty over the Hejaz. Now, the Ottoman Empire, and by the time the 18th century rolls around, had lost really a number of its outlying territories and was in some ways a decaying entity, somehow left out by the Industrial Revolution. And Ottoman authority retreated from the outlying provinces, in particular the Hejaz. So they had a great deal of autonomy, the Sharifs of Mecca, until in the late 18th century, the Wahhabi movement emerged out of the central wilds of Najd of the Arabian Peninsula and took over Mecca and Medina. And for a short period of time, this was probably the only period of time until the Wahhabis, through Ibn Saud, took over the Hejaz in 1925, where the emirs of Mecca were not rulers over that territory. By the 19th century, they came back to power as a result of Ottoman centralizing moves, which tried to bring the Arab provinces back into the fold of the Ottoman Empire. And that became much more acute as the Ottomans lost huge swathes of territory in the Balkans. Until probably the mid-19th century, the Ottoman Empire, although Muslim in form, was to a large extent predominantly Christian, something like 60% of the population of the empire in the early 19th century was mainly in the Balkan provinces, what are now countries like Romania, Serbia, Bulgaria, and Greece, and so on. The Ottomans then tried to reassert their authority over the Hejaz and part of the process of reforming the empire. And in the process, they began to play various clans of the Sharifate family against each other. And while supporting the existing emir, they always kept a kind of replacement sharif or emir in Istanbul under close authority. Faisal's father, Hussein, was just such a person. He was called to Istanbul. Faisal was born in 1883 in Taif, which is a few tens of miles, maybe about 40 or 50 miles southwest of Mecca. He then moved while he was quite young, around 8 years old, to Istanbul, where his father had been recalled there by the Sultan Abdulhamid. And the first few years of his life, he was raised by the Bedouin tribe of Banu Utayba. This is normal Arab.
1 minute.
Oh, goodness. Well, I think I took too long in describing the background. In any case, he moved from Istanbul back to the Arabian Peninsula in the early, around 1908, 1909, after the revolution. And thereupon, he became the right-hand man of his father in trying to put down various rebellions that took place in the Hejaz prior to the outbreak of World War I. The outbreak of World War I, we find him becoming close to the Arab secret societies, the early nationalist movement. And when the rebellion broke out, he became the field commander and was responsible for the various military victories, as it were, of the Arabs throughout the campaign, leading to the occupation or the capture of Damascus in October 1918. He then represented the Arab cause at the Paris Peace Conference and then became, for a very short time, king of an independent Arab government in Syria, which was then overthrown by the French. And then in 1921, he came to Iraq and, after a plebiscite, became king of Iraq and was responsible really for building the modern state of Iraq. I don't think I have much more time to elaborate.
Another couple of minutes.
So what we have, I try to encapsulate really research that has been going on in my mind and in actual fact since 1998 in a very short exposition. The most important factor about Faisal is that he went through various transformations from a commander of his father's and the Ottoman army's forces in the campaigns against rebels in Arabia, two, the field commander of the Arab revolt, two, representing the Arab cause, two, then becoming an advocate of the idea of a moderate Arab nationalism reflected in a confederation of Arab states. And after this was derailed by the French because of the various agreements that they had undertaken with the British during the war in which Syria and Lebanon came under their control, he was ousted from the first independent Arab state in Syria as a result of French military advance that came to a culmination in the Battle of Maysalun. He was then adrift, as it were, for several months in Europe, trying to continue to promote the cause of an Arab independent state in the former territories of the Ottoman Empire. At that point, his presence in Europe coincided with the outbreak of a rebellion in Iraq, in which the British occupation, the British were fighting in a separate theater of war in Mesopotamia. He found himself as being the right candidate, as it were, to represent the kind of government that the British wanted to have in mandated Iraq. Now, the mandate system was introduced by the League of Nations as a form of semi-colonial status for the former Arab territories of the Ottoman Empire. And Faisal, throughout his life, both in Syria and in Iraq, strongly resisted the idea of continuing dependence. And his period in power was marked by a continuing and, in the end, successful struggle to wrest Syria. He failed, but in Iraq he succeeded to wrest Iraq from this dependent status into a form of independence, and it ended with the entry of the country into the League of Nations in 1932. And that was going to be the template for the kind of states that he was hoping would emerge in the Middle East to replace the former imperial domination of the Ottoman Empire. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much to both the speakers for that terrific opening introduction, which I think sets the stage for the making of the modern Middle East. We're going to discuss the history in the books first and then go on to the legacy. And I think I'm going to start off by asking each of the authors what they found most interesting, surprising, or controversial in the other one's book. For me, the interesting thing was the sort of trajectory that Lawrence basically was broken by his experiences, that he had this terrifically successful wartime where he wasn't really... the British thought he was working for them, he thought he was working for the Arabs, although it didn't quite work out as he hoped. But he was so crushed by the disappointments of post-war that he really had a kind of nervous breakdown. And although he occasionally met Faisal when Faisal visited London, it wasn't, I think, a very, 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 very happy meetings, and he then died in that famous motorcycle accident. Whereas Faisal goes from being this aristocratic but rather provincial sort of tribal leader to becoming the father of the modern Arab state, and a really profoundly impressive statesman who's able to outwit the British, although they have, first of all, of course, outwitted him a bit. But anyway, that was to me the most interesting contrast. But I'm going to ask you, Scott, first of all, reading Ali Alawi's book and Faisal, you obviously knew a lot already, but what were the things that most struck you?
I think what most struck me was how the issues that Faisal and Hussein, his father, were facing during the war, and in this constant trying to walk this balance between nationalists and deeply religious fundamentalists, how it can this was the rest of Faisal's life. I mean, he was always caught between trying to balance these two, trying to he had to play to a degree to the British and earlier to the French, And every time he did that, of course, it would alienate another faction of the population. So Faisal just seemed like a man his entire life caught in and having to walk this tightrope and always being besieged from one side or the other, or both simultaneously.
But walking it quite successfully, really.
Working it quite successfully. But I think... he looks like an ancient man I know he was ill also, but when he died, he looks 20 years, 30 years older than he actually was. I think it must have been just an absolutely exhausting existence every day.
It's interesting, both Lawrence and he were very much suffering from the strains they put on their bodies.
That's
in different
right.
Yes,
that's right.
Yeah. And Ali, what was your take on reading about... reading on both about Lawrence and these other mysterious Westerners who are bouncing around the Middle East trying to carve it up to their satisfaction?
Well, I must say, I mean, what I read from Scott's book, especially on the other characters, which I didn't really know much about, I mean, Aaronson and Pufer and these people, Yale, William Yale, of course, left quite a significant cache of documents, especially in his time in Syria. Which played, I think, an important part in...
We should just explain that there are three other characters are William Yale, who was an oil man working for the American government, Kurt Prüfer, who was a German orientalist and spy trying to promote the German cause, and Aronson, who's Aronson, what's his first?
Aaron.
Yes, so there's these three other characters, and you weave them all together. But getting on to the historical events in the book... one of the controversial questions is Faisal's relationship with Weizmann, which is seen by many Arabs as a sort of arch betrayal. How could he possibly allow this sort of proto-Zionist entity to take root in a deal that he didn't even get his side of the bargain? And this was an astonishing misjudgment, and he must have been duped, and it really taints his reputation in the eyes of some of the more sort of maximalist Arab historians, but that's not really your view, is it?
No, it's not, because you have to, I mean, first of all, put it into context, and secondly, you have to look at it in detail. The episode that Scott referred to, where Lawrence got Faisal to sign a kind of agreement with Weizmann, had attached to it a very, very important codicil in Arabic, which was written in Faisal's own hand, which said that none of the agreement that I have signed holds, it's null and void, unless and until all the demands that have been set for by the Arabs are accepted. So whatever he had agreed with Weizmann in that famous episode was negated entirely by the codicil. Again, you have to put it in context. When Weizmann first came to visit Faisal in Aqaba in 1918, this was really at the behest of the British government, the Eastern Committee, which was then conducting the war, as it were, setting the policy for the war in the Near East. And there, at that point, the Zionist project, as seen both by the Arabs and as represented by Weizmann, did not really include the establishment of a political state in Palestine. The way it was presented was that the European Jews, especially those from Eastern Europe and Russia, could find a home in Palestine, bring with them resources, bring with them technology, bring with them the international connections, but there was no specifically political aspect to it. So the first meeting that Weizmann had with Faisal and Aqaba, the discussion revolved around whether it was legitimate for the Arabs in Palestine or for the Arab movement to accept this kind of immigration. And Faisal had no problems with it. And nobody, I think, at that point had any problems with it, because the Zionist project was not framed in terms of a specific state for Jews. Once the Balfour Declaration became public knowledge and the ambiguities that were implicit in it, his opinion changed, and he became much more wary about representations made by Weizmann and others. Weizmann, I might add, was seen as a kind of moderate voice compared to other exponents of the Zionist project. So whenever he met with Faisal, he de-emphasized constantly the political aspect of the project and emphasized that this was to the mutual benefit of all parties and so on. So I think trying to tar Faisal with the brush that he approved of what turned later out to be a political scheme is, I think, first of all, a misreading of history, a misreading of the facts out of and putting them out of context. Later on, I think, if you look at his position in 1920 and subsequently, he was very clear that there has to be a strict division between the presence and the acknowledgement and the accommodation and the willing acceptance of Jewish immigration from Europe into the Near East and the idea of a separate state that is designed around that entity. And in the end, I think he wrote a very detailed exposition of his position to the then British Foreign Secretary, Sir John Simon, making it clear that if Jewish immigration into Palestine was unrestricted, and if it was going to end up in a political entity that would not take into account the rights of the Arab citizens of Palestine, or the residents of Palestine, then the thing will end in tears.
Yeah.
So it was a kind of evolution of a position.
It's very interesting reading both books with today's political and ethnographic lexicon in mind, because the categories that we think of now were really quite different then. And I mean, Faisal didn't think that... He made a big distinction between Arab Jews in Baghdad, who he thought were Arabs first and Jews second, and the question of sort of Jews and Zionism. And it was really quite touching. I think you portray in the book that he died heavily indebted because he was constantly giving donations to different charities, particularly for the minority religions in Baghdad. So he was supporting Jewish causes and Christian, different sorts of Christian causes and so on. It was very touching. But Scott, I want to talk, you're quite interested, I think, in this idea of that what we nowadays think of a state wasn't a particularly relevant or clear concept in the very confused conditions of 1918.
That's right. And I think that Lawrence was trying, among the things Lawrence was trying to warn his own government about was this idea of creating these artificial borders was going to lead to disaster. And by I mentioned in my opening talk that Lawrence really studied in a way that very few British, very few Europeans in period had at the time, the clan and tribal and familial structure of Arab society. And I think understood if you forced some of these deep rifts that existed in different places, if you forced these people into this political invention, that it could only lead to trouble. And it's interesting to me, Professor Lawi and I have talked about this a little bit. I think what you're seeing now throughout the region is a final dismantling, a final fracturing of those boundaries that were imposed almost exactly a century ago. Certainly, Iraq has largely devolved into three semi-nations. Libya, almost even more so. And they very much correspond, the boundaries of these mini states now, very much correspond to the lines that existed under the Ottoman Empire before the Europeans came in and drew lines.
Yeah. Well, that's a very good springboard for getting on to the legacy. But before we do that, I'm very happy to take a few questions or points about history. I'll give initial preference to anybody who's actually read the books. Anyone here actually read these books? Because if you've read the books, you deserve to come in first as a sort of tribute to your thorough preparation. Any questions? Yes,
I've
sir.
I don't have any questions.
Oh, well, that's wonderful. then you just get a round of applause having read the book. Anybody who's both read the books and got either one or both the books and got a question about them? If not, we'll go into people who are going to read the books, which are, of course, on sale. Yes, sir, up there with the... Your head, sir. Well, can you wait till the microphone comes, please? Thanks.
Yeah,
Yes, neither of the speakers have spoken about the rift between Sunni and Shiite, and I'm just wondering where Lawrence stood in this conflict, and indeed whether there was a conflict at that time with Faisal and the Shiites and the Sunnis, because that is what we're dealing with at the moment.
Yes, it's certainly one of the things we're dealing with at the moment. I'm always hesitant about saying that anything is the thing. But let's you first, Scott.
I think in Lawrence's times, certainly, one of the... I'll just take this back to the Ottoman Empire. One of the great secrets of how the Ottoman Empire, which had been in a state of decline for a very, very long time, but one of the secrets of how it survived was the amount of decentralization to it, that different ethnic groups, different religious groups had a tremendous amount of autonomy. So it was almost the very weakness of the central state was the secret key to the Ottoman survival. And so even just the movement of peoples, the world was a much, much bigger place back then. So I don't think that by and large there was the big Shia Sunni issues. Of course, it was in certain places where they were together, but by and large they still enjoyed this sort of autonomy from each other. I think that where Lawrence more focused on flashpoints was in areas where there was much more cosmopolitan, say like Lebanon, where you did have these different groups living amongst each other. But I think in broad brush across the Middle East, it was certainly less of an issue than it is today.
I was very struck in your book about how little role Iran, or as it was then Persia, plays. I think you have a chunk of one chapter about securing the border with Persia, but we've got now with modern Iran a kind of mini superpower, or at least a would-be regional hegemon, and which creates a whole sort of different dynamic to the Shia Sunni divide. But what's your feeling about that question?
No, I think this question is really very, very apt. The Shia Sunni issue, as far as the early Arab national movement was concerned, and Faisal in particular, it was really sectarian blind. The early Arab national movement had a number of Shias in it, so it wasn't a peculiarly Sunni affair. And Faisal himself had a number of Shia advisors, one of whom, Rustam Haider, was possibly his closest friend and confidant. Faisal throughout, and the early Arab nationalist movement was like that, transcended sectarian borders and frontiers. Now, this is at the intellectual, ideological level. However, in specific countries, in Iraq in particular, there was once the Anglo-Indian army invaded Mesopotamia, which was a separate theater of war from Syria and Palestine, the Shia hierarchy, which to some extent was marginalized in the Ottoman Empire and was not given access to privileged positions either in the administration or in the military, took the side of the Ottoman Empire. In fact, led a large detachment to confront the Anglo-Indian invaders. But within a very short period of time, sectarian issues emerged in Iraq as one of the key crises that Faisal faced in the early years in Iraq was a kind of rebellion by the Shia hierarchy, which rejected the kind of state that was evolving in the country. However, Faisal himself, there is absolutely no evidence that either he or even the family in which he was, from which he came, had any sectarian notions or any sectarian feelings. And he went out of his way to ensure that there was a sectarian balance, at least at the highest levels of government and as his own advisors.
Thanks. We'll take two questions in a row. Laura, if you could go to the lady at the back. In the meantime, the gentleman there just next to you, you go first, sir, and then we have the lady.
Thank you. I mean, I think Lawrence...
I was going to have this gentleman first and then
sure.
You. Yes, go ahead, sir.
As we deconstruct the way the countries currently exist in the Middle East, the obvious question, which I think comes out from both speakers' presentation, is for the future, will there be an Arab nation getting together? Could you envisage Iraq and Syria coming together as a single country? And this question can now be asked in all innocence in Great Britain, where the United Kingdom is trying its best to break down into its devolved nations. So we understand the problems of putting together a country and keeping it together on an Arab national basis. Why do you think that will happen, and if not, why not?
Good, that's an excellent springboard for the next bit of the discussion, but I'm going to take this lady's question first. Go ahead, ma'am.
Yes, I think that Lawrence the writer is as compelling a figure as Lawrence the strategist. And my question, or my interest, is in the point where archaeology, and Lawrence was essentially as a young man living in the past, where archaeology flips into intelligence, which flips into military action. And that's an interesting point anyway for all times. So I wonder if you could kind of comment on that, because there seems to be a different trajectory for him. He was going through archaeology, intelligence, action in a kind of a parallel way to politicians and his military commanders. Would you agree with that?
I'll give that to both the panelists. I have to say, if you actually read the Seven Pillars of Wisdom, if you don't do it without quite a detailed map and a notebook behind, bits of it are really exceptionally heavy going. And I think there are bits of it that are brilliant. I would slightly disagree with you that he's as good in writing as he was in warfare. But Scott, he's your special subject.
Yeah, I have to say I'm a bit in agreement with you. It might be a bit sacrilegious for a Lawrence biographer to not adore Seven Pillars, but I think I'm a bit in your camp on that. There's one in particular where he's talking about a 59-hour camel trip across the desert, and there was a moment in reading Seven Pillars where I felt it was taking me 59 hours to read about this trip. As I said earlier, I think once Lawrence got to Arabia, I think he was one of these people, and we've all met them at times, who seem to have this instant affinity for a foreign, instant affinity and instant understanding for a foreign culture. And I think that for Lawrence, that was the Arab world. And I think very quickly, he became less of an archaeologist and more of a cultural anthropologist, and was fascinated by the way, and probably reminded him in some ways of, he'd studied medieval military history at Oxford. And it's interesting when he gets to, after the Arab Revolt, when he gets to Arabia, I think two things that very much stood Lawrence in good stead and made him uniquely suited to the role he played, more than any other British officer who was there certainly, was A, he understood this from the time he had spent in Carchemish at the archaeological site. He understood the way Arab society was put together, but also he understood how to wage war in this really harsh environment. Waging war in Arabia at the beginning of the 20th century looked very much like you dealt with the same primal issues you dealt with in war in 14th century Europe. I want to attack here, but where's the water? Where's the forage for my animals? So I think it made Lawrence really uniquely suited for that. I'm not sure I've answered the question.
No, it's a good answer. It's a very good answer. Anyway. And I was just wondering from an Arab point of view, how is Lawrence seen? Because on the one hand, he sympathised with you. On the other hand, he let you down. He did. I mean, this was an era when the British and other foreign offices still genuinely had people who spoke foreign languages, and there were wonderful titles like Oriental Secretary and Dragoman and so on, and so in a sense any sort of expertise in these dire conditions of today, it was a sort of poignant memory of a bygone age for us. But how is he seen in sort of Iraqi or Arab historiography?
Well, I mean, I can tell you how I see him, but I mean, in Arab historiography generally he's seen to be basically a cat's paw of British imperialism. This is sort of the received wisdom, and this person was above all an intelligence officer, and whatever his other exploits and his antics and so on, he was single-mindedly focused on extending British imperial interests in the Middle East. However, this is a more nuanced view, which is now beginning to emerge in the Arab world, really sees him in a different light. The great disconnect between the Arab perspective on Lawrence as far as I'm concerned, and as it were, the Eurocentric or the Western-centric perspective, is that I don't think that he was not a person who had reached the heights to which people generally attribute to him. For example, in the military campaigns, in the Arab Revolt, there are three events or major incidents in which Lawrence is seen to be instrumental. One of them is the fall of Aqaba. The other one is the Battle of Tafila, for which he was awarded a DSO. And the third one is the events before and during the capture of Damascus.
Let's just have the map up again. I'm not sure these places are all on the map, but at least Damascus is.
I mean, these three events are very, very significant elements of the seven pillars of wisdom. A lot of the Lawrence myth, as it were, is based on that. The Battle of Aqaba itself was not so much Lawrence's brainchild. Faisal had thought about it months before. It was an...
Aqaba, annoyingly, is not on this map. Can you just explain to you?
Okay. Aqaba is...
Oh, so it is. Yes, very good.
It's at the head of the Gulf of Suez. And its significance is that, from Faisal's point of view and from the Arab Revolt's point of view, the significance was that it was the first point outside of the Arabian Peninsula and therefore was a kind of marker for the Arab movement in Syria. So the plan to occupy or to attack Aqaba was already being conceived in the minds of others. When it came to the operational details, the person who actually did the management of the battle was a man called Sharif Nasser. And when the original crew left Wedge, which is where Faisal's forward camp was, to Aqaba, Lawrence was not even part of it. He wanted to be included, and after representations, he was brought in as an exclusive expert. There were only a few dozen people who moved. So in order to mobilize the tribes to converge on Aqaba, it could not have been done by a person like Lawrence. It was done by Sharif Nasser through constant negotiations with tribes and cajoling and bribing and paying in order to create a force that attacked. Now, that doesn't say that Lawrence did not play a part in the actual battle. He did. He was a very brave man. But you could not see him as the fulcrum, as it were, of that.
Your point is not that he was the sinister genius, but just a bit maybe a little bit overrated and over-promoted.
I think so. And I think he also artfully embellished his accounts, because I think he knew that there would be no counter-narrative for a long time coming from an Arab source. But these memoirs have, in the last few years, have come out. For some reason, they've remained unpublished for 8 years, but now they're coming out. And it shows the different balance of forces and the different actors. For example, again, in the Battle of Tafila, where he was awarded a DSO for his action, there's detailed accounts, not only from the Arab side, but from the Turkish side.
Yes.
From the side that was defeated, as it were, as a result of the opening of the Ottoman archives, which shows that the actual battles were, I mean, for example, the Battle of Tafila was mainly by Iraqi officers, and the bravery of a man called Mukhlas, Mawlud Mukhlas, that carried the day. Yeah. So it was an embellished account. That's how I see it. And to some extent, it is not a true and a very veracious exposition of what happened in the Arab Revolt.
Good. Well, I think, I want to move on to we had a great question about the modern Arab world. So did you want to make any further point on that, or should we move on?
Sure. Could I just make one quick point about it? I agree with you about Tafila, but in Aqaba, I think that Lawrence actually did play a very central role. And, oh good, the map's still there. The British and French plan, the British and French plan, one reason why they wanted to be involved in capturing Aqaba was, and there's records of this in British military correspondence, they saw it as a way to box out the Arab revolt from moving into Syria. So, I do believe that Lawrence was instrumental in coming up with the idea of going overland to come at Aqaba from behind. And it's significant that he did so without ever telling a senior British officer, because he knew if he did tell him, he wouldn't be allowed to do it. And taking Aqaba was very easy, but if it was done with British and French assistance, then they could box the Arabs there.
Right. So. When you've bought the books and read them, you'll understand the true brilliance of the discussion we've just been having. So I get it.
So I'm now going to the excellent question here from the gentleman in the yellow tie, which is the springboard for the sort of final half hour of our discussion about the roots, the roots in this era of the modern condition of the Middle East and what conclusions we can draw. So. Do you both remember the question? Yes, you go first.
Sure. I'll answer it in a slightly roundabout way. In 2006, 2007, I was spending a lot of time in Egypt. And I remember this one morning meeting with a woman I was interviewing, and she was very distraught. And she said, oh, did you hear what happened this morning? There was a car bomb. There's at least 80 people dead. And I said, where did this happen? She said, well, Baghdad. And this happened again and again while I was in Cairo, and it occurred to me that I've not experienced this in any other part of the world. There is this sense of kinship that exists throughout the Arab world that transcends these national lines. You know, if I was in Norway and there had been some horrible thing in Greece, people wouldn't have had the same as fellow Europeans. They wouldn't have had the same reaction, I don't believe. So I think all along there is this glue within it. It's this sense of pan-Arab consciousness. And it's very hard to see how that plays at any time in the near future, but amid this period of disintegration and fracturing that's going on throughout the region, it's kind of grasping at straws, but I see that may, at some point, if things calm down, it may be a kind of glue that creates a broader, certainly not one nation state, but it creates more of an idea that we're all in this together.
So you think? So in short, pan-Arabism is not dead.
And I think that it's not dead, and I think it's one of potentially one of the last hopes in the area.
Got it. I suppose the other point one could make, and I certainly felt this very strongly reading your book, was that although people complained like mad about the Ottoman Empire, for most people it was a golden age compared with what happened next.
There's no doubt about it. I mean, I don't want to be wax nostalgic about the Ottoman Empire, but the Arabs for hundreds of years, or the peoples of the Middle East, or the Near East, let's call it that, for hundreds of years, lived under a certain system with which they were familiar, an imperial system that had the forms of Islam, but was extremely decentralized and allowed quite large latitude for particular religious communities. So it was a state with which they were comfortable. The national movement, the national idea, came very late to the Arab world. You can't talk about an Arab national movement until probably the early part of the 20th century. And certainly, it was accelerated during World War I. But nevertheless, it was still seen, the Arabs still saw their future. And Faisal, too, until 1916, tried to see or envisage a future for the Arabs within the framework of a decentralized Ottoman Empire. Now, what happened in World War I is that three conflicting promises or three conflicting policies came about, which subsequently led to what I think was a disastrous outcome for the Arabs. One is the so-called Hussein-McMahon correspondence, which, whichever way you read it, gave a kind of implicit support by the British, by the dominant imperial power, for an Arab state or states reasonably independent in the framework of the Arab provinces of the Near East. Certain areas were excluded. Egypt was excluded. Aden was excluded. Maybe Basra in Iraq would have been excluded. But nevertheless, most of the Arab provinces of the Near East were supposed to be formed in a kind of confederate state with British blessing. The second contradictory policy was Sykes-Picot, which preceded the Hussein-McMahon correspondence, which envisaged an imperial presence for France, Britain, and also Russia in the Near East. Russia was given all of eastern Turkey. As part of course, the Russian aspect fell out after the Bolshevik Revolution. So it contradicted the spirit, as it were, of the Hussein-McMahon agreement. The third thing that came into the pot was the Balfour Declaration, which in its studied ambiguity conflated, as it were, the issue of Jewish immigration into Palestine with the creation of a state in the framework of a national home. The subsequent states that emerged out of this mess, the so-called national states in the Middle East, have proved to be extremely unstable. And the proof of the pudding is in the eating. All the successor states of the Ottoman Empire and the former Arab provinces of the Near East have either disappeared, for example, Hejaz, dismembered Palestine, subject to civil wars, Iraq, Syria, or in a state of near civil war, which is Lebanon. So it is inherently, the structures that have emerged are inherently unstable. I agree with Scott here, is that although Arab nationalism in the strident, extreme, radical form, as expounded either by Nasser or the Ba'ath Party, is, I think, is dead and buried, some form of confederal system that will bring the Arabs of the Middle East closer together is the only, I think, game in town. After we've tried everything else, we've tried militarism, we've tried near fascist government, we've tried extreme radical governments, we've tried socialism, we've tried even communism in South Yemen. And now we have a kind of Islamist moment. There is no other workable framework in which you can bring ethno-sectarian differences and allow them to be transcended, except in some kind of mild Arab patriotism, which Faisal propounded. So we're going back again, we're going back to the future, as it were, where we started from.
So you think this, that mild Arab patriotism can transcend the Sunni-Shia divide and also Muslim-Christian, insofar as there are any Christians left?
It has to be. There is just no other format, because any other format would imply a kind of dominance of one group or one community or one ideology over the rest, or fragmentation.
Let's have some more questions. There's a gentleman there who's been very patient. We've also got a wonderful microphone up there, which has been totally unused so far. So if in the gallery you want to make a question, if you can make your way round and queue in a reasonably orderly way at that microphone, I'll make sure that you get your say too. Let's go ahead. You sir, next, sitting next to the stairs.
My question is to Ali Alawi. Hi, Ali. You start your book by discussing and describing, and very movingly, I think, the passing away of King Faisal. Now, I'm an Iraqi, and all Iraqis would agree that he died too young. My question to you, maybe a little naive, would you speculate as how Iraq would look, how it would be, and maybe perhaps the Middle East, had Faisal died at the age of 70?
Excellent. Very good question. I think I'll take a couple more if there are. Yes, there's a gentleman there at the back who's been very patient, second row at the back, wearing a dark jacket. And there's a lady there, yes, in the pink scarf. You go ahead first, ma'am.
Can you ever see Saudi Arabia agreeing to this vision of a united Arab state?
Good, excellent question. A few billion petrodollars sitting in the way of your vision and a certain amount of Wahhabism. Yes, go ahead. Go ahead, sir.
My question is a bit of a follow-up, actually, to that last one. The early opportunities the Arabs have had to work in a pan-Arab way, for instance, the 60s war against Israel, or even something like OPEC, have not been vast successes. So what do you see as the obstacles to a sort of pan-Arab ideal being realised?
Right, three questions. I'll get to you first, Ali. Speculate on if Faisal had lived. What do we do about the Saudis? And any practical examples of pan-Arab cooperation, all in about 2 or 3 minutes, please.
Well, I mean, to answer whether what would happen to Iraq if Faisal had lived, I think I would even extend it, what would happen to the Middle East if Faisal had lived sort of the biblical 70 years. He would have died then in 1953 instead of 1933. I honestly believe that there would have been a very, very powerful counter-narrative to the Zionist narrative in Palestine. I really think so, because Faisal's overarching concern was to create a sense of nationhood for disparate groups and communities in which the Jews had a place. So there was a vision, as it were, of Arab Jews with a strong Arab identity in addition to their Jewish identity, which would have provided, I think, a very strong counter-narrative to the Zionist claim that they represented international Jewry from whatever part of the world. The other thing I think would have happened is that the institutions of the modern Iraqi state would not have been degraded the way that they were in the various coup d'etats that happened after he died. I don't think we'd have had the kind of confrontation with the British in 1942 that led to another invasion and all the subsequent traumas that came from that. Now, these are, I don't want to go into counterfactual history, but I think it would have been a different outcome, and certainly. And when he died, it wasn't just that Iraqis grieved. The entire Middle East grieved. And it was a scenes of grief that in some ways exceeded those that came with the death of Nasser. Millions of people throughout the area immediately or instinctively felt that a historic leader has departed from the scene. As for the Saudis, I honestly think that we have to plan for a kind of post-princely geriatric regime. If this crew, which has an average age of 80, leaves the scene in the next few years, there are strong centrifugal forces inside Saudi Arabia, which have been covered up by this apparent homogeneity. They may or may not erupt. But I wouldn't bank on Saudi stability 10 years down the line. The other thing that whether there are any incidents or cases of pan-Arab cooperation, absolutely none of any consequence. But that doesn't really negate the idea that one should work towards that end.
Very good. Let's have some more. Did you want to come back on any of this?
No, I.
Yeah. So what was the? I'm not sure which the applause was for.
No.
Let's have some more questions. Go ahead. Yes, the gentleman there in the grey shirt at the back. And then there's and a lady, you put your hand up again. There's someone. You have to make your way round to the microphone, I think. I'm not sure we've got a... Yes. Yes, go ahead.
Is there a chance of a modern-day Faisal emerging that will provide this leadership that the Arabs so badly need?
Excellent. Modern-day Faisal, where is he and would he please stand up? There was a question, someone at the, up there was trying to ask a question, but I don't know whether they've made it to the microphone yet. In the meantime, there was a hand down here I saw. Are you going to ask a question, sir?
Oh, yes, thank you.
Yes. When you get to the microphone, please.
I was interested in what you said, Scott, right at the beginning, that when... Lawrence wanted to study the Arab, you know, he went to Syria and studied Arab, and you were talking about Arabs, the structure of Arab society there as being very representative of Arab culture. That's what was implied in what you said. Now, today we tend to think of Syria, Lebanon, you know, the Levant Arabs as being quite different from the Gulf Arabs. I'd like you to comment on, you know, was it really that similar at the time, and is it now very different from what it was then? I mean, I know there's still the tribal, you know, structures, etc., those are still there, but we do still kind of think of it as being quite different. Thank you.
Yeah. And then we have one more question. Chap at the back in the pale blue shirt, if you can get the microphone to him. I think I'll go to you first, Scott, and then Ali Alawi next. Yes. Yeah. Let's just the microphone get along that. Pass it along quickly. There we are. Thank you. Go ahead, sir.
Thank you. This is a question for Professor Ali. I'm curious how Iraq would ever play a part in this unified Arabia until it starts to tolerate the idea of an independent Kurdistan.
Right. Good. Another nice, easy question. Scott, you go first.
Yeah. When I was talking about Lawrence. Studying the clan and tribal structure, the gentleman's question up there of in Syria. No, I don't think that you can't say this exists in the same form throughout. But I think what Lawrence learned in Syria is when he got to Arabia, that in those strictures and this idea of blood feuds between tribes, between clans, was that much more pronounced in Arabia, and I think that's one of the reasons why he was very impressed from the first moment he met Faisal. Faisal would, and throughout the time that Lawrence was with Faisal, Faisal would gather around sheikhs around him, and it would be this very, very protracted process of coming to a consensus among different families, different tribes, different clans. And again, I think it was, you know, for, to much, much greater import and potentially much greater problem in Arabia than in Syria. But Syria was Lawrence's education to that.
You're welcome to come back on that, but also the question of where are the Faisal of today? I suspect he's probably teaching at an American university and worried it would be blown up in a car bomb or shot if he went back. And then the second question of what about the Kurds?
I think, I mean, to find a Faisal of today, you need to have a person who really privileges the idea of patience, forbearance, wisdom, as it were, and, you know, toleration, in contrast to the idea of a leader as being always powerful and strong and domineering and so on. So it requires, I think, a structural shift in the minds of people as to the kind of leader that is needed. What is certain now is that we have appalling and have had appalling leadership. And I would say since the 1930s, the only person who comes up, as it were, to a kind of international quality of leadership with great faults is Nasser. But Nasser, I think, lost the plot somewhere in the mid-60s and ended up being, I think, a kind of shadow of his former self in the 1950s. So to bring back a person like Faisal, you have to talk about the virtues of such leadership and the virtues of moderation, toleration, and so on are not privileged over strength and power and control, then you're not likely to bring. And I think in order for us to get to that point, we have to go through another cycle of extreme violence and destructiveness, which we seem to be going through now. But in time, I think it will emerge, because ultimately there is no other way of managing the affairs of the area. Now, the Kurds, you mentioned the Kurds and how that would impinge on the idea of a kind of a new version of pan-Arabism. A new version of pan-Arabism cannot be a retread of the old version. It cannot be one in which the whole thing is built around the greatness and glory of this particular ethnicity. It has to be in the form that was originally proposed, which is a kind of mild association of people within a framework that gives the Arabic language, the Arabic culture, not a privileged position, but a unifying position. The Kurds had a quite a significant place in the power system in Iraq during the monarchy. So there were obviously people who rejected it and who were in constant rebellion. In some ways, Kurdish nationalism is probably the last of the 19th century nationalisms that is trying to find an expression in the form of a state. But if you can create the framework, an accommodating framework, which includes them, there's no reason why you can't bring this greater Arab confederation into being with the Kurds not having an accommodating and a very strong position in it. After all, they had that before in the last years of the Ottoman Empire.
Good. There's a few more questions. There's a lady at the back with the red shirt and a gentleman here in the second row. If you just pass the microphone to him. We have you first, sir, and then the lady.
We've heard a lot about men drawing lines on the map and redrawing the lines. I wonder if we could introduce a woman into the conversation. And my question is whether, in your research for both of the authors, Gertrude Bell figures much, or whether Nicole Kidman's forthcoming portrayal is going to lead us to overhype yet another British imperial figure beyond what her influence actually was.
Very so glad you mentioned that. There's also the very interesting case of Weizmann's sister, who plays a role that's not always celebrated in the conventional narratives. We'll get onto that in a moment. Go ahead, ma'am. Yes, in the red shirt.
I had a very similar question, that when you were talking about the development, the political development of King Faisal, do you think the influence of Gertrude Bell was important, or was more made of it? It was said in the various books, I'm sorry if I'm making a speech, I've just happened to have read a couple of books about her, and it was she who was able to explain to her British employers, she's a member of the British intelligence system, how the Arab tribes were formed, and that she helped Faisal to somehow establish a balance between how the British could hold the tribes together, and at the same time he could eventually lose the British. Anyway, would you say the inference of Gertrude Bell was significant or not?
Yes. Well, thank you very much for that. And I'll chuck in a question of my own. And you've had one question already, but I'll give you another very short one because your first one was so good.
Do you think democracy is hindering or helping, actually, the development of the countries in the Middle East?
Okay, thank you. And I'm going to chuck in, I think this will probably be our last round. We're in the sort of final just over 10 minutes. But I have a question also about the role of Britain. It's really, and what I find striking about reading both books is the enormous impact that Britain had on the lives and fates of the people concerned, and how it's always totally unknown outside, I imagine, SOAS and St Anthony's College, Oxford, and a few other places of learning. I'd have thought most of the events and people described here, including the fantastically interesting Gertrude Bell, are largely a closed book. So I'd be interested in your perspective, and perhaps you have a very barbed remark about America as well. I think you said at one point, not the first time America gets it completely wrong. So let's have a, I'd like to hear both your views on Gertrude Bell and both your views on Britain stroke America. And I think with that we'll probably be out of time. Scott, you go first.
I can be very quick about Gertrude Bell. Incredible figure. I don't talk about her in my book because Lawrence and the other characters in my book, it was virtually exclusively through Palestine and Western Syria. Gertrude Bell spent most of the war in Iraq. She did play a very significant role after the war at the Cairo conference. And I just have a very short section in my epilogue about the Cairo conference that Lawrence also was involved in.
Just give us a few words on Miss Weizmann, because that's just...
Oh, that's a great story.
Give it to us in 90 seconds.
90 seconds.
Extraordinary words.
Minna Weizmann was Chaim Weizmann's little sister, and... She was a doctor. She had been trained in Germany. She ended up in Palestine just before the war, as a female surgeon. She ends up being the lover of the German counterintelligence agent, and the German counterintelligence agent, Kurt Prüfer, is trying to figure out a way to find out what's happening in British-held Egypt, and he comes up with the idea that a lot of Jews are leaving Palestine. And a lot of them are pro-German, or they're anti-Russian, the Russians being part of the alliance with Britain and France. So Prüfer actually ended up having his own mistress become one of the first spies he sends to Cairo. She's there for 4 or 5 months, and it is rather the toast of Cairo, again, one of the few female surgeons at the time. She gets caught. But she's so charming and so beautiful that even the Russian ambassador steps in to speak in her defense. She is exiled to Russia. She comes back when the State of Israel is created and becomes a doctor there. Kurt Prüfer went on to become a Nazi diplomat in the 1930s and Hitler's ambassador to Brazil. I'm trying to do the 90 seconds. It's a complicated story. Just by talking fast. In Chaim Weizmann's autobiography, which is 900 pages, there's not one mention of his sister, Minna.
I think just the simple phrase, Chaim Weizmann's sister spied for the Germans, and right, and her case officer later became a Nazi diplomat, is already pretty...
That's
pretty...
Yeah.
That's good. So anyway, no, Ali, Gertrude Bell, and then lessons for the West, and if we have time, which we probably do, a few words on whether democracy is the solution or the problem.
Generally, I would say Gertrude Bell has a better audience in Iraq than Lawrence does. She played, in some ways, a constructive part. For a very short period of time, a central part in the various machinations that went during the Cairo conference. And also she played an important advisory role to Faisal in the first, I would say, 18 months of his rule in Iraq. She was very close to Sir Percy Cox, who was the first High Commissioner, and she was his advisor, Oriental Secretary, and so on. But the greatest British imperial administrator in Iraq was not Percy Cox, but a man called Sir Henry Dobbs, who took, who was indifferent and perhaps even disliked Gertrude Bell. So her influence collapsed precipitously after 1923, and then she became less and less of use to Faisal as an advisor, except perhaps on tribal affairs. And she withdrew into a kind semi, I won't say, she wasn't a recluse, but she withdrew into managing her pet schemes, including founding of the Iraqi Archaeological Museum. In the end, she died probably suicide. And she couldn't, I think, adjust to the loss of her influence. So she had a brief moment, I would say, with the British during World War I, in independent Iraq for about 18 months, and was at first an opponent of and then a convert to the cause of Faisal. And she sort of hero-worshipped him, if you read the diaries and the entries that she had about him. But she has quite a good place, I think, in the hearts of Iraqis, even though some groups, some communities, think of her as being biased against them, which may be true, but that's not a matter. As for democracy...
Let's do democracy first and then yes. Britain.
Okay. Democracy, I think, is without institutions, is basically a recipe for disaster. And in fact, it's turning into that. If democracy is defined as an electoral mechanism for choosing political leaders in the absence of institutional, particularly legal frameworks, strong institutions, judiciary and so on, it will lead to chaos, and it has. As for the British, let Scott answer first.
Okay. Scott, you can do the British and the Americans.
All right. I think what I was very much struck by in researching this book was the degree to which Lawrence trying to head off his own government, taking a disastrous course in the Middle East, how much it mirrored, as an American, my government's, and not that I was in Lawrence's position to warn my government, but how the heedless march into Iraq in 2003, and how, and again and again, the hubris of the empire, that, and it's a combination of hubris and arrogance and ignorance and wishful thinking that they are going to go into these places, and they're going to welcome them, or at least, maybe in the British, I don't think the British thought the locals were going to welcome them, at least tolerate them. Where the Americans, I think, had a much more naive idea of in Iraq. And these voices of dissent, which are often a dissent based on a certain knowledge of the place, are just shunted aside. And in both cases are often seen as unpatriotic. And so I was, in writing this, and especially as I got towards the end of the Paris Peace Conference, I was just so struck in so many things I read and of this movement within the British Foreign Office to marginalize Lawrence, that he was seen as a troublemaker and a fly in the ointment of the French and the British tidying things up. How much it echoed to what happened in my country in the early 2000s.
Did the Americans treat William Yale more seriously than the Brits treated Lawrence in the end?
No. And in fact, even William Yale is a great. He was the only American field intelligence officer in the entire Middle East. He was based in Cairo, and he sent weekly reports back to. There was no CIA or anything then. It was the State Department. He was a special agent for the State Department. He sent weekly reports, and I never saw any cable traffic back to him. It was clear no one was reading his reports. To a couple of points of, he would ask them questions. It's like, did you get my last report? What do you think about this idea? And utter silence. So.
And Ali, you one of your earlier books was called The Occupation of Iraq, Winning the War, Losing the Peace. And I guess that if it hadn't been for the invasion, you'd never have become defence minister or finance minister. You might think that was quite a good thing.
No, I mean, I was against the idea of a military invasion of Iraq, or an occupation, obviously, I was against it. But there was a certain inevitability to it, the way it... But if you have a sort of a historical perspective and see what the British did in 1920-21 in building up the state and what the Americans did, I think the British should feel somewhat proud, I think, of their achievements in Iraq. I'm not an apologist for imperialism, but British administration in Iraq played a very important part in creating the institutional frameworks of the state. And you had really a number of advisors there who were in many ways selfless, spent years, sometimes decades, in thankless tasks, building up the rudiments of administration. And this continued for a long while. So you can make, I think, a positive balance sheet about Iraq's experience with the British post-World War I. The question is that it's not so much what the British did or didn't do. By and large, I think it was a positive influence, especially, as I said, when it comes to administration, the management of the country, introducing systems and so on, and taking the institutions that they proposed seriously, probably more so than the Iraqis that subsequently were involved in managing them. So I don't think it was a completely negative experience. And if you compare the experience of the British in Iraq, or the experience of the Iraqis with the British, and the experience of the Syrians with the French, you can see the difference. And you can see that while one ended in bitterness and conflict, it is true that the British presence in Iraq collapsed in 1958, but it didn't leave the sense of great bitterness that other colonial powers had in their. Now, the sense of dependency and so on obviously is not tolerable over the long run. But one must put things in context. In 1921, when Iraq was formed, it was basically the bringing together of Ottoman provinces, one of which did not even join Iraq until a third of the country did not become part of the country until 1926. So the British played a part, I think, in forming and securing the state, a lesser part than the king. But nevertheless, I think not an altogether bad experience.
Well, on that note, I was expecting a bit of self-flagellation. We were saying beforehand, a London audience loves self-flagellation on the, or not even self-flagellation, being flagellated about the... I mentioned this with Lawrence in mind, of course, on the site of Empath. That wasn't quite what I was expecting, but thank you very much. And on that note, I'm going to urge you, first of all, to go out and buy copies of these books, which are outside, and buy one for yourself and one for each of your friends. And I think they've got plenty in stock. But before you do that, please join me in thanking both our authors for their contributions.